Dr. Max Gershon and some other pioneers were trying to figure out ways to concentrate from juices. They would use hundreds of pounds of carrots and fruits and vegetables and cabbage and apples and so forth. So they were going in a pretty good direction to try and at least target or deal with some of these chronic inflammatory diseases.
No, we can look back at many of the people who were viewed as quacks in the early part of the 20th century, saying, you know, they were on to something, but we basically didn't have the sophistication to realize it. Now, 100 years later, saying, wait a minute, they were not basically all off target completely, because they didn't have the tools, but they had the right insight. Say, there's something, quote, vital sources. Now we call them omega-3 fatty acids. We call them polyphenols. We sound like we're more intelligent, but these are vital agents we have to have. We've been evolving with for hundreds of millions of years. And without adequate levels in the diet, we lend ourselves open to basically increased inflammation. And that makes us fat, makes us sick, and makes us age faster.
Well, with your book, Dr. Barry Sears, The Mediterranean Zone, what is your mission? What is the main message you want to get out to the public?
Basically, you can change your life. You can. It's not that hard, but you need to have knowledge. Without knowledge and without measurements, you're basically rudderless on a sea of life. And then you end up going around and around and around and looking for boogeymen. We see lots of boogeymen today. Fructose, gluten. We see other now new heroes, saturated fats. I said, whoa, doesn't anybody read the literature? You know, again, there's a much more simple aspect. We're looking for a boogeyman to say, what we need is an orchestration. An orchestration based on our best knowledge of science of how nutrients affect gene expression. So hopefully with the book, The Mediterranean Zone, I give more insight into basically what we're looking for and why and how easy it is to do it. And if you follow the very simple prescriptions I put in my book, which are only three. One, you need one hand, one eye, and one watch. So here's how you basically now control inflammation for a lifetime, regardless of your dietary philosophy. At each meal, you divide your plate into three equal sections. On one-third the plate, you put some protein. That'll be determined by your dietary philosophy.
That could be sweet potatoes and black beans. It could be fish.
But again, rich in protein. The sweet potatoes and the black beans are not going to be rich in that. So they can carry a lot of carbohydrates. But find out something that's very protein-rich that fits your philosophy. The other two-thirds of the plate, you fill it full of colorful carbohydrates. They're called fruits and vegetables. And then you add a dash of fat. What's a dash? A small amount. Just make sure it's monounsaturated fat. Things like olive oil and guacamole. Now, why do you need to watch? If you balance your plate correctly, for the next 5 hours, you will not be hungry because you're maintaining blood sugar levels. It seems easy enough. Now, the trick is do it the best you can every meal the rest of your life.
Excellent. Well, Dr. Barry Sears, you've left our audience with some concepts that are easy to follow, that they can replicate and they can do on a daily basis. Because really we know that compliance really makes or breaks whether a person is going to succeed.
It's everything. And that's why we've been led to a pathway we hear saying, take this drug when diet and exercise is not enough. Diet and exercise are always enough if you do it the correct way.
Right.
And again, that a thing I've admired for you for so many years, you say, yes, diet's important, but so is exercise.
Right.
You can't basically, take one out the other. Saying, and add the last thing, which most people never do, stress reduction. The hardest thing, diet's hard, exercise is a little harder, but the hardest is finding a comfortable chair every day, sit in for 20 minutes, and try to think of nothing. That's hard work. So, these are the verities of the ancients. They haven't changed. We just understand now how they affect our gene expression. And that's the exciting part about the future of medicine.
And, for those people who are open to hypnotherapy, NLP, guided imagery, even during that meditation period, at least they can focus on their best intentions, what they're going to do in their life.
Well, and again, that's one of the things that we have. We need times of peace and reflection.
Yes.
And I said the ancients knew this. You need to take time to reflect and basically consolidate information. And what meditation does, it allows you to build the mind like a muscle, that you realize that everything you do or don't do, there'll be a consequence. So if you make a dietary mistake, saying it's fine, as long as I know what the consequences are. So I don't go through life being mindless. That's why you have to basically have a structured dietary program. You have to have a structured exercise program. So these are things you have to do on a daily basis if you want to live longer and live better. To think there's some new breakthrough brewing in some laboratory is a total pipe dream.
Let's address some issues about thyroid dysfunction, adrenal distress, liver dysfunction. What's going on with these organs that we have such a wide degree of deficiencies of, say, thyroid or adrenal function or cortisol, iodine, and so forth? What is your opinion about that?
Inflammation. Because, you know, when you deal with the hormonal systems, these are very tightly orchestrated, the relationships between the hormones. And the easiest way to develop hormone resistance is increased inflammation. We talk about insulin resistance. We have leptin resistance. We also have a lot of other hormone resistance because now the signaling pathways are now compromised by increased inflammation in the cell. And so much of the things we say, we need this or this, saying, maybe we have something more comprehensive. It's saying, if we can reduce the inflammation systemically in the body, then all of a sudden, all of our communication systems, our hormones, begin to work more effectively. Now, this doesn't mean there is not a need for hormonal replacement. But it says, the more I can control the inflammation by my diet, the less of the hormone I need to basically rectify the system. And in endocrinology, standard practice, start low, go slow. What you see now, people say, start high and back off. Saying, wait a minute, this makes no sense. Start with basically getting a stable baseline of the diet, and then slowly add the hormone you think that you've done your best you can by diet and exercise to rectify the signaling transmission, and then slowly add increasing amounts and carefully evaluate how you're doing.
So when you're talking about endocrinological intervention, you're suggesting very low dosages appropriate to the individual's symptoms and their condition, and then monitoring them, retesting them. What is the importance of testing and monitoring for these people?
Well, if you don't test and you don't monitor, you can't manage.
Right.
And, hormones are hundreds of times more powerful than drugs. So you want to treat them with great respect. But if you're not following an anti-inflammatory diet, you're spitting into the wind. Now you're asking for probably more problems than, benefits you'll gain.
So, Dr. Sears, in order of importance to get the polyphenols, to get the most effective omegas, you mentioned spices. Is there anything else higher in foods than spices? And what specific spices or what other foods?
Well, the highest is actually chocolate. not the chocolate bars. They're all diluted with sugar and fat. But unsweetened baker's chocolate. I say, great, I can deal with that. One problem, it's contaminated with cadmium. Mm-hmm. And so because of where the very narrow geographic band where cocoa is grown, it's also very rich in cadmium.
Yeah.
So we have a few problems. So now, say, that's why we go to polyphenol extracts. A recent article just published in Nature last week showed that if you gave a very large amount, close to about 1.5 grams of cocoa polyphenol extracts, you saw a 25% increase in cognitive skills. I want to see my brain increase by 25%, but you have to basically have cocoa extracts, which at those high levels have to be pure. Mm-hmm. And therefore, this is the challenge. We have the knowledge, and we have the tools. The question is, do we have the will as physicians and as patients to follow those rules?
Cacao, is carob different?
Yes.
Okay. So if you were to have the right concentration, what other spices do you like?
I like them all. Because again, remember, we have some 8,000 polyphenols. And saying, as smart as I might be, I'm not that smart. So I throw a lot of spices on my food. Because why? I'm covering my bets. I say that the more spices, and that's one of the most concentrated formats, the more spices I have, the greater the spectrum of polyphenols I'll be getting. And then saying the other foods I like, I think fruits and vegetables, but primarily the non-starchy vegetables, it's hard to overconsume them. It's easy to overconsume fruits. They're tasty, they're rich in sugar, that's why it's easy to overconsume. Mm-hmm. But the data on blueberries is very attractive in terms of mental cognition, in terms of reducing oxidative stress. So as now you get the extracts, that ability to reduce oxidative stress and to basically improve mental condition increases. So again, there's a calling a need for polyphenol extracts, but you still need to have a baseline diet rich in a wide variety of polyphenols to cover your bets.
Oxidative stress, lipid peroxidase, are there certain tests that can be done to measure the levels of oxidative stress?
There's two markers of oxidative stress. One is called isoprostanes. Actually, it's an oxidation product of arachidonic acid. The second, which is actually more germane, is the reduction of oxidized LDL particles. LDL particles never have caused heart disease, but oxidized LDL particles are a true culprit. And you can now measure those. They're not a standard test, but again, it is available in certain laboratories. They can measure the levels and therefore the reduction of those oxidized LDL particles as you consume more polyphenols.
Excellent. Is there anything else that you'd like our audience to know that's important for them to see the future of where you think healthy medicine will go?
I think the future is, you go back to the future. Like I said, Hippocrates said it correctly. Let food be your medicine, let medicine be your food. We've gotten away from that, and we are paying the price. Like I said, this will be a multi-generational way back because of the epigenetic marks we have left. So it will be a challenge for this generation, the next generation, and the generation after. But if we're up to that challenge, we can return to basically the land of milk and honey. Oops. Two of the bad ones. But again, it's saying that there is no individual boogeyman, but we have gone further and further away from orchestration of our food to basically control and manage these powerful communication systems within our body. And the more we understand, we go back to first principles. There lies our future medicine lies not in the pharmacy, but in the kitchen.